much, Reverend McKee. We're turning to Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 1. There may be some here for the first time, so just underline the series of meetings. Your minister asked me some months ago, would I come and speak on practical Christianity? And I began to think of the book of Ephesians. The background is the first three chapters are the doctrine, what you must believe, what we were. We were just sinners like everybody else. But in we're saved in chapter 2, the grace of God. Chapter 1 tells you what you are. You're not just forgiven. You share the riches of Christ. You are a rich saint. You belong to the Lord. And our minds can't take in the blessings that we have already been given. Christian, you already have them. You mightn't be enjoying them, but every blessing you need is already yours. You're a rich saint. It's tremendous. Keep reading chapter 1. The blessings you have. So when you remember who you were, what you are, what you have in Christ, then chapter 4 and verse 1 leads the practical. It gets to the Christian duty now. And this is the key text, chapter 4, verse 1. And Paul now pleads, I therefore, because of who you are, because you are a Christian, you don't do these practical things for God to love you, not at all. It's because you understand his love, love from all eternity. Well, I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that ye walk worthy of the vocation wherewith ye are called. And we noticed on the first study that immediately it's your behavior in the church. In the church, we remember our unity, we recognize our diversity, we respond with maturity, and the result is glory to our Savior and growth, spiritual growth in the church. And then we looked at our speech, for that's what Paul gets on to next, and there's a lot about the speech. And remember, Paul's writing to Christians. I want to underline that. He's not speaking to those who are outside unsaved. And he's saying, don't let any corrupt communication come out of your mouth. In other words, something filthy, repugnant. It's a word for putrid or rotten. And he's talking to Christians. And remember, we went through the different sins, lying, so on. And would Christians lie? Well, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Peter all lied when they were afraid. We ought not to. No excuse for it. But were they men of God? Of course they were. So Paul says, look, you're changed now. Don't be living that old lifestyle. Don't be living that. We looked at the other sins. And we looked, thank God, our speech can be used for good. God can use your speech, Christian, to edify other believers here in the congregation, to encourage people. People need encouragement. And to evangelize. Isn't that a great truth? I don't know if I mentioned the other night, John Bunyan, I'm sure you've read Pilgrim's Progress. You know how he was converted? He mended old, pots and pans, and he heard two ladies talking. He couldn't help eavesdropping. You know what they're talking about? The Lord and the much they loved him, and that's what convicted him and brought him to Christ. He overheard two ladies talk. I wonder if people overheard my conversation. Would it lead them to the Lord? And then we looked last night as our practical behavior towards society, how we're to live. And remember the verse, we're to steal no more, we're to be honest. We're to labor with our hands. There needs to be industry, work. And we can witness to God in our work. Remember we pointed out, let me underline it if you weren't here last night, one thing is really grieving in these days, that sometimes Christians think, well, I'll go to my factory, I'll go to the shop, I'll go to the farm, I'll go to the work, and then have a few hours at the weekend or night to serve the Lord. What an awful, awful perversion of the truth of God's word. Listen, when you're taking care of your children, if you're a mother, when you're working at that factory, when you're out, everything we do is to be the glory of God. That's the Protestant Reformation, what the Reformer said. Everything we do, our leisure, our business, our work, and of course you're needed in the church for spiritual outreach. But, brothers and sisters, that takes the drudgery out of work. Everything we do, 1 Corinthians 10:13, whether we eat or drink, whatever you do, do all to the glory of God. Isn't it wonderful? You can glorify God by what all we do. That would say, well, better get to tonight's in the family, all right? And this is where Paul comes to next. It's a long section, chapter 5, verse 21. I'm not going to read it all. Chapter 5, verse 21. And you can see quite clearly this is the subject of the family. He's going to tell them now, this is how you need to behave. Chapter 5, Ephesians, verse 21. Submitting yourselves one to another in the fear of God. Wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands as unto the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, and he is the Savior of the body. Therefore, as the church is subject unto Christ, so let the wives be to their own husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it. Let's jump down to chapter 6, 1. Chapter 6, verse 1. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor thy father and mother, which is the first commandment, with promise, that it may be well with thee, and thou mayest live long on the earth. And ye fathers, provoke not your children to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. Let us pray for his blessing. Father in heaven, we've been thinking of practical behavior that's expected of those who name thy name. Lord, we're conscious we fail. We're not perfect, but thank thee there is forgiveness with thee. But Lord, may we think this evening upon these practical behavior patterns that are set out for us. Lord, we thank thee. It's amazing that in the congregation there in Ephesus, as the people would meet and hear this letter read, not only from Paul, but from the Lord himself, there was a message for husbands, there was a message for wives, there was a message for parents, there was a message for children, even the young children born again in the congregation. Lord, speak to every one of us tonight, we pray, in our Savior's name. Amen. Walking worthily in the family. Practical Christianity, just like charity, begins at home. The religion that is not real at home is not real anywhere. It's at the home where our faith is really tested and proved. Now, this is not just for those in the family. There may be some here and you are not married. You have no family at all. And you're all alone. Well, it's for you too, because you need friendship. The Bible says it's not good for a person to be alone. We all need friendships, and we're in a church family. So don't be thinking, well, it's not just for me then. It's for all of us. There are lessons here that are profitable for all of us. And also, we're not being judgmental. Of course, families fail. We all fail. Sometimes families break up. It's tragic, but we're not pointing the finger at anyone. There's no perfect family. My wife often says that. Every family has its problems. Well, you may think yours is perfect, but, there's no perfect family. The Savior's wasn't. Did you ever read the family tree of the Savior? Read about the four. Do you know Rahab the harlot was an ancestress of the Savior? Ruth the Moabitess. Tamar, who committed immorality. You read it. Bathsheba. Those were in his family tree, and yet the Son of God chose to be born into that family line way back. When Christ was alive, his own half-brothers and sisters didn't believe in him, you know that? In fact, they actually doubted his sanity. Does that not underline there's no perfect families? Now, of course, that wasn't the Savior's fault. He lived perfectly and sinlessly. But yet his own half-brothers didn't believe in him till after his resurrection. Thank God some of them did. We know that from Scripture. So I'm saying there's no perfect family. But in your notes, and I trust you'll use them to look up later, I want you to think of the pressures upon the family. We don't have time to go into the specific duties of a father, mother, husband, wife, children, and so on. We don't have time tonight. They're there. The whole series could be preached on them. But bringing out some things. First of all, I want you to think of the pressures. You see, in the day in which we live, there's tremendous pressure upon all the families. Family life is dying out as we knew it some years ago. You think of marriage rates. Some parts it's less than 50% even marry. And we're living in a new age for many of us. We couldn't believe it 30, 40 years ago. And there's tremendous pressure upon families. There's even extreme left-wing fanatics who actually state that the family unit should be done away with. That may shock you, but there are. And there's others who are trying to do away with the family unit because of gross immorality we don't need to mention. So the family's under pressure, but listen, the Christian family is under intense pressure because the Christian family's under pressure by Satan. How do we know that? Because the first family, Adam and Eve, our original parents, Satan attacked that family unit. You know the story of the fall in the garden. You know what happened. Satan's out to destroy your family, Christian. Because Satan knows, he knows what we ought to know, that a Christian family living for the Lord, practicing Christian behavior, is a tremendous witness to the community. And it's also, as we talked about, salt. I've no object tonight. I suppose myself, because I'm married and a husband and a father. But no objects tonight. Christian families are so important to a society. And as the family goes, so goes the church and so goes the nation. Satan, listen, Satan's out to attack the families of this church. He's out to attack your family, if you're a Christian family. Out to attack you. He did it to Adam and Eve. And you know what happened? Of course, it brought in sin. Sin came in to the world. And of course, the first family, do you know the very first son born into the first family became a murderer, and he murdered his own brother? That's what sin does. Destroys the family. Satan's out to destroy the family. Sin's out to destroy the family. And sin brought selfishness. And that's seen in the very first marriage. That's you know, Christian, we're not perfect. And sin can still come. And we can be tempted to these things. So you've got Satan. And of course, I've given you the verse, just if you have your Bible open, chapter 6, verse 11 and 12. You've got Satan. You see, the wiles of the devil, chapter 6, verse 11. You're told in verse 12 of chapter 6 that we wrestle not against flesh and blood. In other words, Satan's out against you, and there's a whole section there in the spiritual armor. But then sin brought selfishness. Do you remember chapter 2 and verse 3, the lusts? Now, lust doesn't necessarily mean immorality. This is chapter 2 and 3. It's there in your notes. I've put the scripture down. It means desires of the flesh. What does that simply mean? Selfishness. I'll do what I want. Nobody's going to tell me what to do. Is that not the age in which we live? And people say, even God's not going to tell me what to do. I'll live my life as I please. That's selfishness. And that attacks a Christian marriage because the two become one. But if one says, I want my way, I want my way, there's problems in the marriage and the home. So selfishness. And that's what we were like before we were saved. We're all selfish. I'm not saying unsaved people can't have a fairly stable marriage because maybe they'll compromise because they realize the ramifications. But listen, selfishness, and that happened in the first family. You remember the Lord says, Adam, where art thou? Adam, remember what he said? Who told thee? Remember about eat of the fruit? And what did Adam say? The wife. He blamed his wife. Some men have been doing that ever since Adam. All right? He blamed his wife. And he actually blamed God. He said, the woman thou givest me. And what did Eve do? She blamed the serpent, and the serpent didn't have a leg to stand on. All right? That's where blaming started. Are there any families where you ever start blaming other family members? It started in the garden through sin, Satan, and selfishness. But in your notes, chapter 2, verse 2, according to the course of this world, that means society. Christian, society that we live in today is trying to pressure you and your family into its mold. I like watermelons, and I remember some years ago smiling when I read that, you know, in Japan, farmers are growing watermelons in square perspex boxes. You know, they put the plant in. You know why? Because it's forced into the mold. You know, the watermelon's not the round shape. It's square, so you can slice it easier. Now, why that? Do you know, that's what society is trying to do to you here in Macrofield Free Presbyterian Church. Do you know, the devil is using society out there to mold you, to get you to change your views, to get you to think you Christians are just old-fashioned. The Bible's out of date. These sins that the Bible, don't dare condemn them as sin. You dare not say that such and such is wrong. You dare not say God says it's wrong. Oh, you're hurting our feelings. We'll take you to court. You're not politically correct, and so on. The world is trying to mold us and is trying to legitimize these sins. And that's why, parent, you be careful what your children are watching on social media, what they see in the television. And you need to regulate what you watch, because that's all getting into your mind. It's all going into your mind. Things start in the mind. We're pressured to live. What is advertising? Some of you may be in the advertising business, but I have to say this. The basis of advertising, I know for good things it can be. Of course, we advertise missions, but really, adverts on TV, you know, what are they? They're trying to make you feel you can't live without that. All right? They're trying to pressure you to buy it. Oh, I never knew I needed that. I'll have to get it. And you know what happens today? And I have to bring this in, because I want to be practical, and I've spoken before on the Christian and money. Do you know the Lord is concerned about how you acquire your money, your attitude to money, and your administration of your money? There are 2,000 verses in Scripture on your money and your wealth and how to handle it. There's only 500 verses on prayer. And it's so sad that many young people today haven't been taught to add, to do their sums. Remember watching an advert some years ago on television. Here's the wife and the husband sitting with the children. Oh, it's great, they're giving us the loan. It's great. And we've enough money over to buy a car. And if you looked at the small print, and I quickly got the calculator and worked, I can't remember the figures now, the exorbitant money that have to pay back over the next 5 years. Crazy. Just want to understand, if it started to save some money, compound interest, what it would be worth in a few years. You know, the Bible tells you to invest your money. The Lord said that. You remember the Lord condemned a man because he put his the talent in the ground, didn't invest it to get interest? Well, I don't preach the sermon tonight in that. But here's the point. Do you know what the experts say? And I'm not an expert, but the authorities tell us the biggest problem in families, break up in families and in marriages, is debt, money. Till debt us do part. Seriously. You just check it. That's what they say. Money, fights among a married couple or families over money, over getting into debt. I used to tell at weddings, when I was doing a wedding, I would say the problem in Northern Ireland is there's too many people buying things they don't need with money they don't have to impress people they don't even like. I'm sure you've all heard that before, haven't you? Did you follow that? Too many people buying things they don't need with money they don't have to impress people they don't even like in the first place. Keeping up with the Joneses. One man said to me, I gave my wife plastic surgery. I cut her cards up, plastic cards. But anyway, men can spend us too, by the way. Sorry, ladies, I have to watch my speech. And sometimes at weddings, I'd say, don't let the marriage get into problem. There's a marriage I heard about. Theirs was a perfect marriage, but for one feminine flaw. He was quick on the deposit, but she was faster on the draw. And again, I have to be honest, some men can be fast in the draw. Now, I'm being serious. Be very careful. When I was young, I know my wife too and her family, as a little girl, you didn't buy things until you saved the money. Now, I'm not saying it's wrong to borrow. Not what I'm saying. But be careful. And many a marriage has gone into shipwreck because they haven't followed the biblical teaching. And it's an Old and New Testament on how to handle your finances. So look out. Satan can't rob you of your salvation, Christian, but Satan is out to stop you enjoying the blessings of your salvation. And Satan, Christian, listen tonight.
So important. Satan is out to disrupt every Christian family connected with this congregation. He wants to cause disharmony. He wants to cause disunity in your marriage and in your family. That's what he's trying to do. He's a murderer from the beginning, and he's a liar. So let's not Satan or society or our selfishness affect us. Well, let's get to the second one, principles. How do we then apply it in the family? Well, salvation, you need to be saved. I'm not talking tonight on general principles of marriage. Bookshops are full of them. Books, how to be happy though this, how to be happy though that, and so on. Well, we're not here to talk about that. There may be good advice to some of them. We're talking about the Word of God. And a Christian marriage starts with salvation. Salvation. You see, when Adam sinned, he brought sin into the world. No longer do we want to know God or love God or obey God. That's what it means to be made in the image of God. Some people have still this crazy notion that means God is a body. God is a spirit. What it means that we're made in the image of God is God is a person. Now, God the Son took a human body, but God is a spirit. You saw no similitude of him, God told the Israelites. That's why it's blasphemous to make an idol. But he's a person. God is a person. In other words, he thinks, he acts. We know all that. What does it mean to be made in the image of God? We're different than animals. Adam was created with a mind to know God and to think, with emotions to love God, with a will to obey God, but when he sinned, that was lost. That was what we mean by total depravity. That's what we are without Christ, without salvation. Yes, a person may do good works or do good things, be moral than other people, but he's dead spiritually until we're saved and we're washed from our sins, but we become new. It's only a Christian can live the Christian life, but it's only a Christian has Christ living in them. The Spirit of God comes in to live. So you need to be saved. So I'm talking to the Christian in the family. The Christian in the family. And salvation delivers us from the power of Satan. Not only from the penalty of our sin, but we're saved to be delivered from the power of sin. One day from the presence of sin, but from the power. It's only when you're saved you can have the power to live in your relationships with your friends and your family. But then I've put down the scriptures. You see, I was struck, if you look quickly at the Bible there in verse 31 of chapter 5. For this cause shall a man leave his father and mother and shall be joined unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh. Here's the point I'm making. You have it there, and you have it over in chapter 6, verse 2 and 3. Honor thy father and mother. You see that? First commandment. You know what Paul's doing? Paul is reminding those believers of scriptures that were already there. What he's saying is, Christian, you've got the scripture. And of course, Ephesians has become scripture. See, Ephesians was just written when they heard it read. I'm underlining the fact, how are we enabled to live as a Christian family should? The scriptures. You must follow the scriptures. Follow the maker's directions. Now, you see sometimes when you buy these things from IKEA or whatever, and if you're like me, you get a big box and you open it and there's stuff everywhere and you go, how will this ever fit together? Well, follow maker's instructions. They're very hard to follow. I am, and I'm not handy that way. God designed the family. And in these passages, which I can't go into tonight, and there's also more in other places, 1 Peter 3, for instance, there's a whole chapter, 7 verses on the duties of husband and wife. You should read that. Don't read it now when I'm preaching. When you go home, read 1 Peter 3. Whole chapter tells wives, if you're living with an unsaved husband who's hard on you, well, tells you what to do. That may be, or it can be the other, but husband living with an unsaved wife, but it actually... See, the Bible's practical, isn't it? It tells wives, if your husband's not saved, don't nag him. Don't leave him, but live the life before him. I always smile when I read 1 Peter 3. I remember preaching some years ago, and I said to the congregation, do you notice there's 6 verses to instruction to wives? And there's only one verse to husbands. And all the men laughed. And I said, you know why that is? Because the husbands were so difficult to live with. And I'm right, by the way. You check it later. You check it later. But seriously, it's in the... God has given you instructions on how to live in a Christian family. And we ought to read these, and you'll have to take time later, this section. So, are you saved? Are you following the scriptures? Now, are you? Are you saved tonight? Can you honestly say, I will follow God's word no matter what it says? Will you? It's easy to say it with our lips. But I could tell you of times, and one is my mind, I'm not obviously going to say when or where. Young lady, involved in the Christian work, played the organ in the mission hall, that's all I'll say. Came to see me with fiance, Marius, turned to him. She said, oh yes, are you saved? Oh yes, I'm a communicant member for a number of years. Are you saved? No, I'm not a Christian. Go to church now and again, but no, I'm not a Christian. You just go, what? But surely, you've heard me speak, and the minister before me, about the unequal yoke. A Christian is to marry in the Lord. Yes, I've heard you saying that. I know that, but this is different because we love each other. Listen, it happens. And that's why I'm asking you tonight, Christian, is the Bible really your authority? I know we'll defend it and say, West Church believes the Bible. And thank God for that. I thank God I'm in the free church that defends this book. Amen for that. But listen, is it really your authority? Is it? Or is it feelings? Is it desires? That's the thing. And then chapter 5:18, you have to be spirit-filled. I'll get to that tomorrow night, so we can't really stay much with it. Chapter 5:18, the command. This is a command. It's not for just some special Christian. The last part, be filled with the Spirit. And you see what immediately follows. It talks about speaking to yourself and so on. Then it says, husband, wife, child. Some people have the idea the fullness of the Spirit, that's for missionaries, that's for ministers, that's for Sunday school teachers, that's for us as we go out to witness. Thank God we do go in His power. We need His enablement. Pray for your minister. He'll be constantly filled to preach and anointed. That's a slightly different thing, anointed. But listen, and I'm serious on this. Father, when you're playing with your toddler on the carpet floor, you ought to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Oh, you should. Mother, when you're feeding your young born baby, or you're doing the dishes, or you're talking to some of the family, listen, we should not be living any of our life without the control of the Holy Spirit. You think about that. It's for all areas of our life. Study the passage. We must be filled with the Holy Spirit. And in other words, you can never be the husband, wife, father, mother, child that you ought to be, that God wants you to be, if you don't know the control of the Holy Spirit of God in your life. And every day you're surrendering to Him and saying, not my will, but thine be done. Well, what will be the result? Well, the practical Christianity we've been talking about all week. You see, when I thought about it, what's to walk worthy in the family? Exactly what we've looked at during the week. Those behavior patterns we talked about, they'll go out. And sadly, and I thank God it's not too often, but I've met some in my ministry, and we're not saying we're perfect. No, we're not pointing that way. I've just said we're all imperfect. We sin. But I think of two incidents. One, I wasn't personally involved, but a very close ministerial friend of mine knows it. Now, it happened quite a few years ago, as you'll realize. A man who attended the church and used to pray so eloquently in the meetings, would talk to people about being saved and so on. He died. A couple of the elders went round to the house to sympathize with the wife and the daughter, grown-up daughter. very sorry about your husband's death. We'll miss him terribly in the church. And you know what the daughter said? We're not sorry he's dead. I'm glad he's dead. Because listen, he wasn't the same man at home as he was where he hung his hat on a Sunday. We're glad he's dead. That's a true story. I had an experience once where I knew of a family. I knew quite a few of the children. And I knew there had been a father, never knew him, but he was very ill in hospital. There was only two or three of children, a large family, would even go and visit him. And yet they told me, I took part in the funeral, but they told me that when they were young, they went to a certain church, and their father was there in the limelight. And what I shivered when I was told the brute that he was at home to those children. Absolute bully. The way he treated them. Unbelievable. I'll not go into it. Shocking. You see, the older I get, and I'm speaking about myself now, it's not what I say. It's not the words. Do I walk the walk? Does my life back up my profession? You see, we ought not to be surprised. Now, it's very rare. Thank God it's rare, what I've just told you. But it happens. It happens. You see, home is where Christianity begins. That's what you are. That's what I am. No more, no less. And we ought not to be surprised at that, because you know what the Lord said about the Pharisees? You remember, they were the holiest in society. They were the holy religious leaders. And they did walk. I mean, you know, as regards outward morality, the Pharisee was so, but you know what the Lord said? You're a bunch of hypocrites because you're stealing your aged parents' money. You check it out. You're saying, oh, I'm so religious to the Lord, I can't look after them and so on. I'm doing God. You're a hypocrite. You're not even caring for your aged parents. Oh, but they look so holy. Oh, it's a terrible thing, this, but we'd better move on a bit here from that. It's very sad. But what I'm saying is, in family, you must display these things. It's in your life. You must have these things. It's a very sad. I know I'm telling sad things now. I only say it because Ma Sunday said it herself. You ever heard of Billy Sunday? Man that led his own wife after Billy died did say. Do you know there are three children. Not one of them professed faith. The two boys were alcoholics. Newspapers at that time, when he was having a particular mission, highlighted one of the sons was drunk down the street. Ma Sunday actually wrote afterwards, and I don't know if it's true or not, but she thought it was. Billy and I, but she traveled with him and organized the campaigns. Billy and I were so busy saving the world, we forgot about our own children. My wife and I sometimes say, we regret, we're so busy. And in one way, it was great to be in the Ravenhill Church when God was working. This was before martyrs were built, the Ulster Hall Day. Some of you will tell me that. We were out every night of the week, 16, 17, 18, 19 year old. But you looking back on it, we'd often say to each other, because my wife's parents weren't saved, they ran a shop. But see, my wife was too busy to be there at night. We were out doing, he looks back and says, oh, I wonder should we have taken a few nights off from all the church work and spent time with the unsaved parents? Now, I can't tell you how to balance your time. But remember, we have all of responsibility to our families. Remember that. Parents, your children will soon grow up and be gone. Ask the Lord to guide you. I can't tell you how many nights in the church I met. But listen, all I'm saying is make sure you have time for your family, especially unsaved ones in your family. And here's something I want to say too. You see, in any family, make sure to give plenty of doses of God's miracle medicine. Medicine works wonders, and God is a medicine that works wonders. I'll give you the verse, Proverbs 17:22. You know what it says? A merry heart doeth good like a medicine. Somebody once said this, the way to raise children is to be firm, be fair, and be fun. Does your family have laugh? Do you? A Christian family ought to have humor. It ought to be happy. It ought to be, the children in a Christian home ought to be the happiest children. And by the way, make the Sabbath a delight. Sabbath day shouldn't be a day when somebody told me they had the poor children, I'm talking young primary, were made to sit on the couch and fold their arms, and if they talked or moved, the dad hit them. Listen, that's not Christianity. Make it the best day for your young children. Give them special storybooks, Bible storybooks, special colouring in books. Sit with them. Make them look forward to that day. You may laugh at this, but when I was a boy, we lived in Belfast Terraced House. We were what they called a parlour. And we never get into it during the week unless something important. But you know, on a Sunday night, we lit the fire in the parlour and we sat around and toasted the bread at the fire. You say, like, what's that got to do with Christianity? You know what we were doing that day, Sunday special. I know it was to worship the Lord. We went four times on Sundays to church until Sunday school, at least three, maybe four. But make that day special. We used to have special dinners. Of course, now we have special dinners every day, don't we? We're so wealthy. But make Sunday special. There should be fun in your family. It says, a merry heart doeth good like a medicine. And I could keep you for hours here talking about the things that we laugh about. I was talking to someone just the other day. My wife said for many years, Ron, when you retire, I'll get you a BMW. Now, anybody own a BMW, just close your ears, all right? There's other good cars. She says, Ron, you retire, I'm going to get you a BMW. That's what you'll get. And she kept her word. It was the first Christmas after retired, she got me a BMW. She did. It's about that size. It actually works with a wee battery, and I took the grandchildren out into the street, and somebody, bro, look at that. And she went into a BMW and got me a hat. By the way, I drive a car I'm happy with. Don't be feeling sorry for me. But that sits in our good room, as we call it. And when all the family come, the grandchildren still look at it and smile. We'll laugh about it. Or the time I kept budgies as a boy when I was in my teens. And then my daughter decided to get her some in the cages and they laid a few eggs and then just couldn't get any. And every morning I'd go out and one morning I'd into breakfast all excited and smiling. Oh, there's an egg in the nest box. And my children, they're only young, old one was at primary school, and they laughed and laughed. My wife had put a mint imperial in. They still keep us going about that. By the way, we bred budgies later with another son and we did have success. But things that got to joke, sometimes when I'm out, people wonder why I'm beginning to smile. Sometimes when you go to a church after some time, do you know what somebody will say to you? Oh, I haven't seen you for a lot of years, you haven't changed. Do you ever say that? When I hear somebody saying that, I can hardly keep my face straight. Because we come back from Papua New Guinea as missionaries in 1980 for about a year. We lived in the top of the Shankill, Fourth River Road. I remember the name of one family beside us, the other family I couldn't remember, but some time ago, I was in Cumber, stopped at a service station, and a man came up to me. You're the Reverend Johnson, aren't you? I said, that's right, I've seen you. He said, I used to live beside you. And that was 1980, just into 81, and I'm talking over 30 years later. I knew what he said. You haven't changed a bit. So I went home, into Newton Ards. I said, Rhema, I met that man living next door to us. You mean the Dixons? No, the other side. I couldn't remember them. She remembered. Women usually do that, a good memory. And he said to me, Rhema, he looked at me and he said, you haven't changed a bit. And my wife, just like that, at the split second, she laughed. She says, Ron, what he meant was you were old, grey and ugly back then too. So, you see, I'm glad I married a wife that was a great encourager. And keeps you going. But have a laugh. Have a laugh. There's nothing wrong. There should be fun in the family. There should be fun in the family. But let's get to these basic commands. How do you live practically? Well, love. I've given you the references. You see that? do I need to read them all to you? Look at how many times love. Chapter 4 and 2, walk in love. Sorry, chapter 4, 2, were the love in the church. Then 15, speak in love. Chapter 5, verse 2, speaks about walk in love. And then chapter 25, or verse 25 and 28 of chapter 5, husbands, love your wives. Love. Do you know this world is a perverted, lying view of love? By the media and the songs, they talk about love as some type of uncontrollable passion. You fall into love and you fall out of love, and oh, I can't help loving this. What utter garbage. Now, I'm not saying romantic is not a romantic. I'm not, but listen, that's garbage. It's rubbish. That's not love. That's not love at all. Love is described in the Bible. Love is a matter of choice. You can choose to love. Oh, you can. And love can be taught. Do you know in Titus chapter 2, verse 2, if there were any older women here tonight, I would tell you, older women, you have to teach in this congregation. Do you know your teachers, older women in a congregation, are to be teachers? Titus 2, verse 2. Paul wrote and he says, you older women, teach the younger women how to love their husbands and their children. So don't listen to this nonsense that love is just some soppy zap you get. Oh, I just love. Love is when you put the other interest before your own. Love is a matter of choice of how you treat that person. That's what the Bible calls love. That's what God did for us. He loved us. Christ loved us. Was there some sort of feeling Christ had? No. He put your interest before his own and went to Calvary for you. That's love. The sacrifice. You sacrifice for that other person. I remember a man came to see me once, Christian man. In the manse, he says, you know, marriage is over. Just don't love her anymore. I said, you're a Christian, yes. You don't love your wife anymore? Oh, I've no feelings of love anymore for her. I said, are you really saved? I am. So I turned him here to chapter 5. If you have it open before you there, in chapter 5, I turned to him and I said, is that right? Are you sure? Look at verse 25 of chapter 5, and I showed him in the Bible, husbands, love your wives, and you're to love them even as Christ loved the church. You're to give yourself for your wife. I said, you say you're a Christian and you love the Lord? How can you sit there and deliberately tell me you're going to defy his command? God doesn't tell Christian husbands you love your wife if you feel like it. Or you love your wife if she's lovable to you. It doesn't say that. Isn't the world corrupted our thinking? No, the world has no idea what love is. Love, we're to love our wives. We're to love our wives. It's a command of Scripture. You see, believer, when you were a hell-deserving sinner, Christ came and he loved you. And when you begin to think of what Christ did for you and his love, then, and it, not just husband and wife, but anyone, family, friends, you say, oh, they've done something very unlovable. How could I love them? Christ loved us. What was there about us that could cause Christ to love us? Love is helping those people. Practical Christianity. And then you go back to chapter 4, verse 2, and you've got, here's how you ought to behave in your Christian family. This is what makes a Christian family. Not selfishness, not me getting my way, but chapter 4, verse 2, lowliness. You take the lowly place. You consciously say, because I love Christ, I'm going to serve the rest of the family members. Meekness. It's not weakness. You have the power, but no. Forbearing one another. Oh, that means if a family member speaks angrily, you don't speak angrily back. You just take it. They shouldn't speak to you that way, but you're not going to make the situation worse. And then I think of down in verse 31 of chapter 4, no bitterness. Chapter 4, no bitterness. Don't be bitter. You know what it says actually over in Colossians when Paul wrote? He said, husbands, be not bitter against your wife. Remember, a preacher said, wives are often called the better half, but don't let you men be called the bitter half. The bitter half. He actually says that in Colossians 3. Husbands, don't be bitter. And it goes to anybody, don't. And then verse 32 of chapter 4, forgiving one another. That's how we act in the family. You can't have a proper Christian family if we don't learn to forgive one another. And notice it's one another. Both of us, if you're married, both of you will need to forgive each other because we're not perfect. Any relationship in life, there's going to be that. Forgiving one another. I had a man, he said every time his wife and he have a row, she gets very historical. He says, oh, you mean hysterical? No, historical. She keeps bringing up the past all the time. Well, never do that in the family. Don't bring up the past. It's gone. It's forgiven. And parents, oh, I wish I had time in this, but parents, we're thinking of love. Your duty as a Christian parent is to assure your child that you love them no matter what. Even when they grow into manhood or womanhood and they choose to go the wrong way and they're making life choices that are so grieving to you, I'm not saying you don't make that clear that you're hurt, but make sure that they know that you love them no matter what. Isn't that what the father did in the story of the prodigal son? Even though his son was away off in the far country, still loved him, longing for him to come back. And never ever, I don't think anyone would do this here, but never, ever, ever tell a child, you be good so God will love you. Or you be good so mommy and daddy will love you. Listen, those words should never cross a Christian's lips. It's blasphemy as regards God. Imagine telling somebody you be good and God will love you. No, he loves us when we're sinners. Terrible thought. And to tell a child, oh, you be good, so will I love you. You love your child whether he's good or bad. When they're good, it gives you a love that brings you joy. But when they're bad, they're still your child. You love them. Never, never say, well, very quickly, I've gone again, time. But the other word is submission. And look at verse 21 very quickly. Submitting yourselves one to another in the fear of God. That's for husbands too. It's very sad if there's any Christian would turn to their wife and say, listen, Ephesians 5 says, wife, you're to be submissive to me. Listen, you don't understand the first this passage. You don't understand what it's saying at all. Yes, there is an order, and yes, the wife. It's not inferiority. It doesn't tell the husband you're to make your wife be submissive. It doesn't say that. That's something to do with the wife. You're to show the love, but everyone in the family is to be submissive. Everyone in the friendship, everyone in the church, the family. Submission. It's not inferiority. You see, the Lord Jesus Christ submitted himself to his Father's will to come into this world, even to the death of the cross. He submitted himself as a child to Mary and to Joseph. He willingly submitted himself. So submission is a willing saying that I am going to put you first. John Calvin said when a father lovingly gives himself, in other words, puts himself out to care for his child, that's a loving submission. All we do is putting that other person, that's what we're talking about. And the very last point I can just mention to you for time, the preeminent person in the family is who? Well, I've shown you there, husbands, wives, children, even as Christ, as unto the Lord. You see, your motivation to be the Christian family, to be the husband, wife, child, daughter, and so on that you ought to be, is Christ. When you think of his willing submission to go to Calvary, submitted to the God the Father's will, when you think of his love, well, that ought to, in your life, give that desire that I will seek to love others And I will seek to be submissive. In other words, help them. It's the whole idea. I'm sure you've seen the illustration, but it's worth using again. You know what a triangle like, a pyramid, something similar? Well, you know the different points of a pyramid. And the closer those lines, you know, like a triangle lines, they get closer and closer and closer the higher they go. And here you have a Christian husband and wife, or let's say a family. You see, the closer each of you get to Christ, the more and more each of you individually submit to the Savior and say, Lord, I want to please you. You've done so much for me. When I think of your death on Calvary and what you've made me, you're both getting closer to Christ. And what happens? You get closer to each other. And you know that harmony. And you become the marriage or the family or the friends that God wants you to be. You see, Christ has to be the center of the relationship. Bear with me. I think I'll just take a few moments. Turn to Romans 12. Wasn't good. It's not in your notes, but just to sum it up, I think this verse might sum up the whole thing. We are under pressure because this verse brings these things together. So just give me a few more minutes of your time, if you could. Romans chapter 12. And it's very similar to the book of Ephesians in the first 11 chapters are doctrine. And then from chapter 12, he gets into your duty, and it's very practical. But in Romans chapter 12, Paul says, I beseech, idea of what the verse in Ephesians 4, I beseech you therefore, because of your blessings, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. He's saying, Christian, give your life to the Lord. Let him control what you say, what you hear, what this, make it practical. Give your body means, Lord, here's my life. Bishop Taylor Smith used to, before he got out of bed, he was a general, chief chaplain in the First World War, used to say, Lord, I'm making this bed an altar and here's my body. Use it whatever day you want today. This is practical Christianity. Lord, you take my life, everything about me. Verse 2, and be not conformed to this world. There's the pressure. There's the pressure from the world in our families, in our lives. But be ye transformed. You can, you know, when people get saved, maybe they've been married, they're not saved, and they get married, or the family. You know what they tell me sometimes? Our family's changed. Our marriage has changed. Why? They've been transformed. Are you transformed? Look, how do you get transformed? By the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. You know what this is saying? If you will surrender to the Lord and say, you're Lord of my life, I'll obey the scriptures, I'll walk with you, I'll obey you no matter what, you know what will happen? You'll be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Look at that phrase, renewing of your mind. You remember in school, that's passive. In other words, can you see what Paul's saying? Christian, you cannot renew your own mind. Paul is not saying you'll overcome the pressures of this world to get you to think like it by you renewing your own mind. No, it says as you give your life to the Lord and say, control what I see, what I say, what I do, everything. Lord, my life is yours. I want my time to be directed by you. I want all I do to be directed. I want my relationships. You're in control of everything in my life. You know what happens? The Holy Spirit does something within your mind, heart, and will. And he causes you to desire what's right and true and spiritual and lovely. And the things of the world, the pressures are overcome. You present your body. He renews your mind. And as Christians, when we live in this world, that's filth of this world, we need our minds renewed every day. We do. You mightn't realize that how the world is affecting us. How the attitudes and philosophies of this world affect us, but they do. And that's why we need to come to the book and surrender our life to the Lord afresh, continually. And the Holy Spirit will give us a new mind, the mind of Christ, because he is the Spirit of Christ, and we'll see issues as he sees them, and we'll be enabled to be the husband, wife, parent, child that we ought to be. May God help us. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we confess that we don't even realize how much we're affected by the pressures of this world and its thinking. Lord, deliver us from ever doubting the authenticity, the accuracy, the authority of the Word of God, but that our lives would be subject to the commands of God. And Lord, that Thou would come and enable us to give our lives to Thee, would say in the words of the hymn, take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, for Thee. Take my lips, take my feet, take my hands. Lord, I want them to live for Thee. I want to be used by Thee. Come and renew my mind. Give me the mind of Christ. Lord, may this be the cry of every believer tonight. And we pray the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit may rest, remain, and abide upon us until our Savior comes or calls.